everybody to this last tutorial in the introductory session. This tutorial will be about version control with Git. And I'm very happy that so many of you came here, because this is not strictly speaking a tutorial about something related to Python, but this is much more general, the concept of version control. And I think if you didn't do version control so far, you will profit by using it no matter what you're actually doing, what kind of code you're developing, even if you write papers together with colleagues, let's say, in the natural sciences, very often this is written in LaTeX, that's also in a sense code which you're writing, even then you can profit from version control. And if I can convince some of you to use version control in the future, I'll be very happy. I'd like to start by introducing myself. Some of you might have seen me in the NumPy tutorial yesterday. I'm a theoretical physicist at the University of Augsburg. I have been coming to EuroSciPy since about 8 years, and in particular version control is something which I heard about at EuroSciPy, and at some point I thought I should start this and really use it. In particular, if you start contributing to open source projects, which actually you should consider, because in the end you're using, most of you are probably using open software, then you should also consider giving something back. This might at an initial stage seem very unlikely. I mean, I remember very well when in Paris, Fernando Paris asked us to do pull requests. I didn't even know what a pull request is. I'm going to explain it if I have enough time today. I could never imagine that I could contribute to an open software project, because I mean there are all these great coders out there, and I felt that I'm completely unable to contribute. But in the end, it turns out that there are places where you can contribute, and even if it's writing some documentation or something where you feel confident that you can do something, well, why not consider doing that? And then version control will be useful, in particular with Git, but version control is also very useful for your own projects. Now, if you're still in doubt that you're in the right tutorial here, let's go through a short quiz. So, if you earn at least 1 point, you should better stay here. So, first question is, do you write 100% bug-free code with all features implemented from the very beginning? No reason to, I mean, I don't even want to know the answer, but there's one in the back. He has 0 points so far. Okay, but he's the only one. Okay, probably most of you have already earned 1 point. I definitely would have earned 1 point. Next question, do you collaborate with others? Of course, everybody collaborates with people. You don't? Still 0 points? Do you want to contribute to open software? Of course you want me to do that. I just explained that you should consider that. So I think you have earned at least 1 point, maybe 3 points. You can ask the question slightly differently. So one or more points, version control is for you. Does your directory occasionally look like that?
Never.
Even remotely. Do you recognize this? To some extent, maybe? Big mess. So sad. Now, this is Twitter style. Call this style, but I mean, this is always binary. You know this now, since there's a new US president. He would also tweet something like that. You'll use a great version control system. VCS is a version control system. And we will not pay for it, it's free. It will be fantastic. Okay? So, you really should stay here. And I think you'll get the impression that it's really worth using it. Now, maybe a brief history, because you might think, if you don't use already version control systems, that this is something very new. In fact, version control is pretty old. I mean, this is a short part of the history, but the first well-known source control system, SCCS, was developed in the early 70s, so that's last millennium, informatics. It's really old. The first system I was using was RCS. And just to tell you a little bit the differences to what we have today, in RCS, for example, a commit, basically a new version which you were creating, always consisted of one single file. I mean, sometimes you do logical changes to your code, which imply that you change several files at the same time. This concept somehow didn't exist in RCS. This was based on a single file. And even more importantly, you had to lock the file. If you wanted to change a file, you had to lock it. You had to say, this is my file now. Nobody else can touch it. I'm changing it. And when I'm done, I put it back and somebody else can take it. Which is extremely inconvenient if you're collaborating with other people. But this made sure that there are no conflicts. I mean, if you're taking my file, you edit something, I edit something, and then we put it back, you might have changed the same parts which I have changed. And that's, of course, inconvenient. There are solutions to this problem, we'll come to that. Then there were CVS, Subversion. Subversion is still a system which is heavily used. This is a so-called centralized version control system, and I'm discussing this difference between the centralized version control system like Subversion and the distributed version control systems like Git, Mercurial, or Parser, for example. This difference I'll explain on the next slides. Now, Mercurial is actually the Python-based version control system. However, Git has been much more popular recently, so that's why I'll be talking here about Git. And Git actually means a stupid or worthless person, especially a man. Git was developed by Linus Torvalds, the creator of Linux, and he once said that his two big projects, Linux and Git, he named basically after himself, Linux, or it's related to his first name, Linus. Well, and Git is a stupid or worthless person. I don't think you can say this about Torvalds, but I think it was sort of fun on his side. Okay. So, I already mentioned there are centralized version control systems and there are distributed version control systems. And it's worth looking into the difference because one concept which you might associate with versions doesn't work for the decentralized version control systems. So suppose you have clients developing code, some people with whom you are collaborating on a project, and you have a central server where everybody puts his versions of some files. Then, of course, at each single time, there is a well-defined version on the central server, right? So, for example, person 1 is putting file 1 and 2 onto the server, and this is what's called revision 1. And then person 2 is maybe changing file 2, file 1, leaves file 2, no, sorry, the idea was to leave file 1 untouched, changes file 2 and adds a file 3. So there's a new revision on the central server, and so on. So at every point in time, there's a well-defined revision like this revision fork, which consists of three different files in different versions. And this is only possible because there's one central server, which at a given time has a certain set of files. This is nice as long as you have always internet connection. Now we learned here during the tutorials that you don't always have a good internet connection. Sometimes you're traveling, and you might end up working during your travel, and you want to record changes, and you just don't have connection to the central server. Even nowadays, I mean, and the German railways have, even second class, they have internet connection. This is not always reliable, so this is typically not such a good solution, actually. So people came up with decentralized version control systems. And the idea is basically that, again, we have like three clients here, and they have their own repository where they store their files. So that's basically your hard disk, on your computer. So you can store new versions of your file all the time whenever you like. And somehow there should be means of communication between these different repositories so that you can exchange versions. That means that at a given time, there's nothing like a revision. It doesn't make sense to talk about a revision number 4, right? Because revision number 4 for this person here might be something completely different from revision 4 for this person. So for this reason, what used to be revisions in the centralized version control systems, these commits here, consist of a commit object, which has a number, which just contains some hexadecimal numbers, digits from 0 to 9, and ABCDEF. These are basically the names of these objects and the file objects which make up this commit here. Basically. This is a somewhat simplified version. So the main point is here, indeed, you cannot talk about your revision number 10. You talk about these so-called hash values. And these hash values actually identify your file. They are basically unique. If you think about it, this hash value consists really of 40 hexadecimal values. I only show 7, usually that's good enough. Now 40 hexadecimal numbers, this corresponds to 10 to the 48 different hashes. This is really a lot. 10 to the 48 is huge. And this allows basically to distinguish all the versions of the object commits which you're creating. So usually the first 7 hex digits are good enough to identify an object, so you don't need to type in 40 digits. There's no reason for that. Now you probably see that this is a bit inconvenient because you have to set up connections between different computers. So suppose choose 3 people here, you are working on a project together. Now you have to allow connection by your neighbors and so on. This is of course a bit complicated. So what people usually do is they communicate via a central server, which is GitHub. That's a server which you can use, or a GitLab instance. That's basically more or less the same software. Many computing centers offer such a GitLab server, and this is a centralized server where you can put your work. So in principle, if you're traveling, you can keep a record of your versions, and at a later point, when you happen to have internet connection, you push your commits to the centralized server, and somebody else can take your work and get it from there and continue to work on it. So these are basically the different models we'll be discussing. And for the beginning, we'll be only concerned with this part here. So you're alone, you're a user, you're developing your software, and you're putting versions on your local disk. And later, if you have enough time, we'll come to the point where we consider this GitHub server, and I'll talk briefly about how one works together with the GitHub server. Now, before we go more deeply into all this, I would really like to encourage you to ask questions. Right? So the experience is that if somebody asks a question, there are probably 5 more people in the room who just didn't dare to ask this question, so please interrupt me at any time. So, are there questions up to now?
You showed us a very nice list of version 2, version 3, or date for this. But sometimes it's useful to have, like in the software version 0.16, because this is a policy that you want to share with people.
You mean like a release or something like that? Yes.
Combined with the
Oh, sure. I mean, we'll come to that. I'll show you how you can tag a certain version. This is basically a label which you can put to a commit, which is like version 1.5 or something, so that this is a well-defined version and you can always come back. I mean, actually, when you look on the GitHub repository of my NumPy tutorial, I created a tag for 2016 because I gave the tutorial already last year. And I'll put a label 2017, probably once the Eurosupply is over. So then you have well-defined relations which you can use, which have a meaning, which have much bigger meaning, and that's actually of some importance. If you consider these hexadecimal values, they are not really useful. Right? So, right. And that can be done. More questions? Then probably the next big point is, where do you get Git from? Well, basically you go to this address here, and there you'll find binaries for Windows and for Mac, and you find install instructions for Linux, and I'm sure nobody is running Solaris here, I guess. But I mean, this also exists. I mean, who has installed Git already? Most of you, right? There are probably a few who haven't installed it. I mean, it's not essential that you really follow what I'm doing, even though it's nice if you can follow. There's no Jupyter notebook as you're used to during the other tutorials, but we'll try to make a small project using Git. If you don't have a Git installation, just team up with a neighbor. Maybe you can look at the same screen. And this is also a great place to find the reference documentation, to find the online version of a book, these two guys here, ProGit, which you can also buy as a real book. There are several translations, for example, there's a version in German. There are some partial translations. You'll find instructional videos there and much more. So this is really a website which you might take a look at. Now, the question always is, where do you get help? So Git actually is very extensive in giving you help. In many situations where something seems to be going wrong, Git suggests what you could do, and we'll come to this as we go on. But for the moment, the first thing which you could do is you could just say Git help. And you really get a lot of information. See, this is pretty long. Lists you some of the more important commands. So for example, the first one is clone. So you could say git help clone, and you get more information. Really lots of information. Basically, all what I'm talking about, even if I type it in the terminal, will be more or less in the presentation here. So you can download the PDF later on, and you'll have basically all the information here. Yeah?
Question. Why are there all commands?
No,
they are extensive, but where do I get them? On the CLI, all the commands are very
good. Git remote is not in this list. This is true. I mean, you can always get, say, git help remote, of course, if you know the command already. Or there is, for example, I mean, of course, you can go to the reference documentation. That would be one way. But you get the important point, first of all, is you need to be able to get information on the command remote, for example. And you get it, of course. But as you say, you need to know this command. There's maybe one interesting thing which you might consider doing. This is git help minus g. This will list you a number of guides which tell you interesting things about different situations. And I'm pretty sure, even though I cannot really promise it, that you'll find remote somewhere also in this list here. For example, there's this git help every day, and this gives you a list or a discussion of the most important 20 commands or so. Right? Or typical workflows. And there's also a tutorial introduction to Git. There you can find really a lot of information. So this is something you might want to look at, GitHub minus G. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Or.
But I mean, just having the commands, I mean, you also need to know what you're looking for, so. But I mean, there's really plenty of documentation. Now, what I want to do is I want to go with you through the main workflow working on a Git repository. And so the idea is to have a small project, I call it the primetime project, because the question is to find out how many prime numbers can be integrated as a time in hours and minutes. So, for example, 2179 is a prime number, but obviously 21 hours, 79 minutes is not a valid time. In contrast, 2137 is also a prime, and 20 hours, 37 minutes is a valid time, and so on. And the idea is that if you have short primes like 7, you can put zeros in front. So 0 corresponds to 0 hours, 07, 7 minutes after midnight is a valid time. So the question is, how many prime numbers are there which can represent valid time in this sense? And what we are going to do is we use a Git repository. So we are going to use a Git repository to develop code for this problem. So even if you have heard about Python for the first time in yesterday's tutorial, don't worry. I mean, the code won't be very complicated. It's not the important part of this tutorial. We'll be writing some code, but that's not the most important part. Okay, so how do we start a Git repository? I'll do everything here on the command line. If you're a Windows user, there are some shells where you have drop-down menus where you can see the most important commands which you can use, but I'll do everything here on the shell. So the first thing is that we go to a new directory, and if you want, you can. If you want, you can follow along. So I create a directory. It's readable from the back. It's probably a bit difficult. Should I switch off the light?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Is this okay for everybody, or is it too dark now? It's probably better to read them. Welcome, the sun is coming from the sun. So please tell me if it becomes too difficult to read.
I think that if you can inverse the black and the white.
This I could try, yeah. Is better?
Yeah, but now it's
but now it's smaller again, I guess. Okay. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. It's not really as much as I okay. This should hopefully work. So we can go to this directory, primetime. And now before you get started, you just say git init. So every command starts with git, and then there is a subcommand which tells git what it's supposed to do, and there might be some further arguments. So just say git init. And git tells you, maybe I should have this audience switch to English. Basically, it says it has created or initialized an empty Git repository. And what actually has happened, I mean, if you look at the content of this repository, it looks like nothing has happened. But in fact, what has happened is a subdirectory .git, a hidden directory .git was created. Now, this directory should never touch, please. Unless you really know what you're doing, but there's basically no reason to touch this. Because that's where all your revisions are, all your different versions of your files. So if you mess with this directory, or if you delete it, all your version control is gone. Unless you have to start it somewhere else as well. Yeah. So this is really, really important. So if you look inside .git, you see that there's a whole structure. In particular, there's a directory for all the objects and the references and so on, for branches. That's where all the information is basically stored. Now, maybe one point here, it looked like you have to start with an empty project. You have to start at the very beginning. And of course, that's usually what you're going to do. You want to do a project. You want to use version control. So you start with an empty project. You say git init, and then you start from the very beginning. But it's also possible that while you're working on a project, you realize that you would need version control. For example, 2 weeks ago, I was working on a small thing, just one script I wrote in Python, thought I'm never going to need version control there. But then this grew more complicated, I wanted to change the program, and then I just set git init, and I started at that point with the version control. That's no problem at all. So even if I would have had already files in this directory, I could still have started git at that point. I could have set git init, I would have obtained this directory.git, and I could start to do version control. So if you don't do it from the very beginning, it's not all lost. You can start with your version control from any point. So just to show this optically, this is really important.
Yeah.
Well, reinitialize existing Git repository. That's probably not what you want to do. You better don't do that. I mean, if you want, we can try this after our first commit, then we can really check what happens. Yeah, let's do that after we do our first commit. Then nothing really bad has happened.
Can I put a git into a git?
Git into a git, what do you mean by that?
I mean, if I put my git folder into a git folder, and I reinitialize it, you can revert it back.
I mean, I would say that doesn't really make sense. Then I would rather go for a backup version. Yeah, that you use a GitHub server, for example, to host your project there. Then you have a sort of backup, at least for most of your work. But putting Git under version control, I don't think that anybody is doing that. I mean, what people are doing is, of course, these are backups, incremental backups, then you can always go back to a given version at some point. But, I mean, you would have to do everything, I mean, creating new commit in each step for your main repository and for the super repository. So, no, that's, I mean, the way out is really to be more careful. Okay, one thing before you get started is, because in the logs which Git is maintaining, it's keeping track of who is making contributions, you should tell Git your name and your email address. Let me maybe briefly show you how that looks like in practice. Better go to another. Let's see. Let's go, no matter where, just some file. And there's this blame, and you can find out who has, okay, this is not a very interesting one. Let's Here you see for each line who has contributed this last version. So Git is really keeping track of who is doing what. I mean, you probably remember this guy, particularly if you have been to the SciPy tutorial. Rael is here, he's one of these contributors, main contributors to the SciPy lecture notes, and you can find out exactly which lines he's responsible for. So you should tell Git who you are. So you say git config. Now, Git allows you to store your identity or other preferences on a very global level, basically for all users on your machine, or globally for all projects. You can also decide that in one project you will be called by one name, in another project you want to be called by another name. You can do this locally. I just do this now with the option global. This will define my name for every project I'm doing on this account. And I don't want to be called differently dependent on the project. And then you just say user.name, and then of course you put your name. And you check this by means of the config this list. Actually I did a mistake. Should have put quotes around it. Okay. You need the quotes because of the blank in between. And then you should define your email address. So email. Then with git config list, you can check that everything is correct, and if you made a typo, you can still correct it by doing another git config on this key to email or username. Then what is often useful is to define the editor which you want to use. So one thing I'm going to do is specify the editor, which in my case is the BI, which is not valid. Fine. This will make sure that I get my editor which I want to use. If you have a preferred editor, you prefer Emacs or whatever editor you want to use, you can specify it here. Because there are sometimes occasions where Git will bring up an editor, and if this is an editor which you're not familiar with, you might already have trouble getting out of the editor. So you better specify an editor which you know how to work with. Okay, and in this way we have set up Git. I mean, you can specify many properties of Git at this point. I'm not going through all these properties. I think it's more important to go through the main workflow. There are many more options which you can switch on or off or define at this point. Let's rather start developing our code. So I'm defining a script primetime.py. And there I define a function def is time. So the ideas I mean this is not necessarily great code which I'm writing. There will be no documentation, nothing, because this is a talk about Git and not a talk about Python. So I want to write a function which takes some integer n and returns whether this integer can be defined, can be interpreted as a time or not. So what I simply do is I
do a division by 100. This mod will give me the, well, the division, the integer division, n by 100. These are the hours. And the rest of it is the second part of this tuple. These are the minutes. And then now I can just return the result of 0 less equal hours less equals 23. So the hours should be between 0 and 23, including 0 and 23. And the minutes, of course, should be between 0 and 59. If you have never seen that in Python, you are able to stack these comparisons, so you can really say 0 less equal HH less equal 23. And now to see how many different possible hours or times there are, we say print of the sum of is time of n for n in the range up to 2359. Okay. So what this does is it goes through all the numbers between 0 and 2359, checks whether it's a time. If it's false, this is 0. If it's true, this is interpreted as 1. We sum over all these values, and this gives us the number of times which are available. And these are, of course, 24 times 60, which is 1440. Let's see when our program runs. Correctly. Okay. Looks reasonable. So now we have a file. And of course, what we now want to do is we want to keep this version of the file. I'll put it up again, just for those who haven't finished typing it. We have a new file. This looks reasonable, gave us a correct result. So this is already worth putting into version control. So now we really have to explore a bit how this works. So the first thing which you can do, and which I recommend that you do whenever you don't know what the situation really is with your repository, just ask for the status. Whenever you don't know what's going on, if you need maybe help, first take a look at the status. And what Python, what Git tells us here is there's an untracked file, which is called primetime.py. Untracked means Git has seen that there is this file, but it doesn't care about that. It's untracked. But it also tells you, and that's what I said in the beginning, it gives you a lot of help. I mean, it tells you what to do with this file. If you want to include it in a commit, you should add it. Git add file name. So that's what we are going to do. Git add primetime.py. Okay, now you're asking what has happened. Well, we just check it. Git status.
Is that also some git add
or well, you could put star, but usually you don't want to do that. Usually you want to define which files you want to really put into a commit. Because, I mean, there's some logic to it. I mean, you're doing a commit because you have implemented some feature or you have corrected some error or so. This affects specific files, and you put them into the commit. So usually you don't want to put everything there. Actually, in some cases, you don't even want to have all files under version control, and we'll see an example as we go on. So now you see that something has changed. Now this file displayed in red is now displayed in green, which means Git knows about it, and it says changes which have been done to this file will be committed. That means, and that's important, that you have put this file in this version in which it was into a special area, the so-called staging area, from where the commit will be done. It's also possible at this point to add additional files to the staging area and to commit them. So you can collect all the files which are relevant for what you are doing right now and for which you want to have a new version, basically. So in order to make this a bit more clear, let's take a look at this image. So what really happens is you have a working directory. That's what you're looking at when you're typing in the terminal. That's the file which has been modified, and the file name was shown in red. We have added it to a staging area. It turned green. It's now staged. So by add, we put it into the staging area. We could put more files into the staging area. And then in the next step, by means of the commit, we put it really in the repository.
Yeah.
This is a repository on the local machine. This is always on the local machine. So, and that means you have the full history locally. So if you're working without an internet connection, everything works fine. You have everything local. And you can decide at a later point to push this to another machine. Okay, so this is really important. There's a two-step process. And the reason is that you want to collect maybe a number of files into a commit. Now in our case, we just commit this, I guess. See, yeah. So git commit. Actually, what git tells you here is if you want to unstage it, if you want to take it back because the add was a mistake, you can just remove it in this way, and then you get back to the previous version. So git commit, and there you can add a commit message with minus m, and our commit message can be added function to identify types. Now we can try git status again. Nothing to commit, working tree, everything is perfect. So that means in our working directory we still have our file, but it's also in the repository. Now you have this great idea, I want to do an init. So let's take a look at it. Let's do maybe the following. Take a look at git objects. So here you see there are a number of objects here in these directories. So if I look into 73, there's actually one of these objects which is called 73DC8765 and so on. That's one of the objects which we have created. Now you have this great idea of saying git init. Reinitialized existing git repository. Let's look at the objects. They're actually still there. So you're lucky. But still, I wouldn't recommend to do that. Because I don't know what it does to the history. But your objects are still there. So it's not as bad as one could expect.
Yes, I'm just worried if I make mistakes of what I.
But the rule is don't do a git init if there's no good reason to do it. Okay. Are there more questions? Let's see, that was on the git status. Let me go back. So the question is, what does it mean, this minus minus cache? So it basically restores the Well, it puts this back from the staging area. Basically, it removes it, this cached version from the staging area. So actually, you might have, I mean, maybe at this point, it's maybe important to realize that you can have three different versions of file primetime.py. Let me just do the following, just for the fun of it. Let's put some docs here. Because we have committed this, let me do the following. Let me add this file. And let me grant some models. Oops. So now you see we have actually three different versions of primetime.py. We have the present version, which actually is not in the staging area yet. This is what we have in the working directory. That's our last change. Then we have staged a version, and then there's a version in the repository. Right? And now what you need to do is you need to remove this file from the staging area. In this case, well, you would actually reset, I mean, if you want to unstage here, you would reset head. That's basically the pointer. To the version where you really are. That's the most recent version. I mean, this is basically. So head is basically the most recent version defined by this, basically by this commit in our case. That would be head. In fact, I mean, here you can see that all the changes which you need to undo, they can be undone basically by the commands which are listed here. So in this sense, it gives you a lot of help here. Now I need to clean up. So I just do this git reset head, primetime. Let's see. And then I can, for example, check out primetime pi status. Now everything is fine again. And our file looks as it is supposed to. Okay. Now you have seen that in order to do the commit, I've used the option minus m to define a commit message. You always, as a rule, should define a commit message. Because later on, you want to look through your repository and you want to know what has happened in a certain version. Because you might be looking for certain changes which you have done at some point. So really put a descriptive message there, which is not too long, so that it can fit on one line. So if you look at the log in a one-line version, you see that if your description is too long, this will not fit on one line here. But it will look like that. We'll have longer histories later on. There's this number of the commit and the description which you have inserted. If you don't use the option minus m, that's fine. What Git will do is it will open up an editor and give you a chance to type in your commit. Your commit message. Okay. Maybe some more comments on commits. I said the commit message shouldn't be too long, not longer typically than 50 characters. I've already mentioned a commit can contain several files. So you can put several files into the staging area and then do a commit. One strategy is to use so-called atomic commits. What does an atomic commit mean? Well, an atom is something which is indivisible, at least for the old Greek philosophers. Nowadays we can divide atoms into smaller parts. But an atom is something indivisible. So this would be the smallest logical unit which describes your changes. Yeah? So it makes sense not to change something there in the documentation and implement some new feature somewhere else and do something more in some other file and put everything into one commit. Try, sometimes hard at the beginning, but try to do commits which have a certain logic. If you do different things in different places, do several commits. So it's not necessarily a good strategy to work a whole day long and then in the evening just to do a commit, because you have typically done lots of different things and you have a hard time later on to find the version where a change has happened. So you can easily imagine you work a whole working day, in the evening you find out that your program doesn't work anymore. Then you don't have a chance to find a version where this error was introduced. It's among all these changes which you have done during the day. And that's not a good strategy. So whenever you do a given change, which has a logical, which forms a logical unit, do a commit. That's a reasonable strategy.
So, in commit, again, for example, this, something, some file,
yeah.
Updated, I don't know, three times,
or it was less. Here I have just committed this one version. I mean, all the other versions which I have created were just to show this point with the git init. I mean, we are now going on, we are changing files as we go on, and there will be further commits, of course. I mean, for the moment, this is one commit which we did, which basically implemented this function which checks whether a given integer is a time or not. Right? That's basically one logical step in a sense. If you have made several changes, actually it's nice to know that there's this option minus p to the add command, which allows you to select which parts of the file should actually be committed. So if you have made several changes, you can say keep this change, but don't consider this change for the moment and so on. That can be quite useful actually. Okay, now we need to find out whether a number is a prime number. So let's do that. And I want to do this into a different file for a reason, not in the primetime file. So let me create a new script, primes.py. Now this will be extremely inefficient. But of course, that's often how programming works. You write a program, and you're going to make it better as you go on. So let's just do that. Dev is prime. N. If n less than 2, then we know this is not a prime number. We become false. If now we go to through all divisors, if divisor in range starting at 2 up to n minus 1. Now this is stupid. Some of you might recognize this, but let's do it this way anyway. If not n percent divisor. So if there is, if n isn't divisible by divisor without any rest, then we don't have a prime number, and if you don't find a divisor, then obviously we have found a prime. Return true. This is not at all a good way to implement such a function, but never mind. Script, the import from primes, the import is prime, and print is prime. So the idea is this comprehension here. We go through all numbers from 0 to 2359, take all those values which are interpretable as times, take these values and check that they are prime. If they are prime, we sum them up and print the number of valid results. So you see, at this point, we have done two things. We have created a function which checks for prime numbers, and at the same time uses this function. That's for us now a logical unit which we will commit. But maybe before committing it, let's check whether everything works fine. Python prime time prime. How many prime numbers do you think there are which can be interpreted as times, just roughly? Can't be more than 1440. What do you think? Are there any guesses? Feeling? No? No idea. Okay. We've made something wrong. The research not defined. There's a certain range, of course. Now, let's take a look at the status again. Well, there is this primetime file, which Git knows already about, but it's not yet staged for commit. It's not in the staging area. Then there is the file primes.py, which we have created, which Git doesn't care about for the moment. And there's also this directory pycache, which we really don't care about. That's where Python put some byte-compiled code. This is created during the import. That's why I actually imported this file here. So this is something which we really don't want. So what you can do at that point is you can define a git ignore file. In a git ignore file, you can write down all files which you want to, which you don't want to consider for commit. So, for example, I mean, is somebody using LaTeX for writing papers here? Yeah. So you create log files, you create aux files, all these files which you never care about in the revision control. So you just list them in this file. You say star.log, for example, and then all these files which you're not interested in will not be considered by Git. So what we do is we create a file, git ignore, with a dot in front. This is a hidden file. And in this hidden file, we put underscore underscore pycache underscore underscore slash. It's for, in both cases, two underscores. Status again. Now the pycache directory is not listed anymore, but we have this git ignore file. So let's first commit the git ignore file. So git add git dot git ignore git commit minus m edit git ignore file. Now we have only the prime time pi and the primes pi left. We add this to the staging area. So git add primes.py and primes. And git add prime time.py. So now primes pi and prime time pi are in the staging area. So If I'm doing anything too fast, just interrupt me. Yeah?
So every time I have to put grind time again into the staging area.
Right. Because it's not obvious. If you, for example, we had the modified grind time already at the same time when we created this git ignore file. But we wanted to have this git ignore file in a commit separately from any changes we made to grind time, because these two things are not at all related. So that's our way to distinguish between the different files. We have to say what is part of the commit which we are doing right now. That's why we need to put this file specifically into the staging area. So now if you check the status, both files are there, and we can just commit it, we commit. Okay, now I've forgotten the option minus M, I didn't put a commit message there. Function to identify primes, edit. And now this is committed. So if I look at the log, I might now have three versions which are nicely described. It's clear who has created them, when, and you know what these IDs. So this is the essential, the very basic essential workflow. Is this clear so far? Are there any questions up to this point?
Can both files be in the same directory?
No, you can have subdirectories, of course.
Yeah. Only subdirectories or in a...
No, I mean the reference directory is where the .git lies. And there's actually only one .git in your main directory. So if you create subdirectories, there are no .git files there. It's all in the main directory. But everything above is not looked at by Git. It shouldn't be looked at, actually. Here. Now, an important concept are branches. So, for example, one strategy could be that on your branch, and actually, you might have noticed, if you look at git status, it says on branch master, so there's actually a branch. Yeah? If you say git branch, you see that you're on a branch which is called master. And a good strategy, but not the only possible one, is to have in master always a program which is actually running, which is fine. And now you want to change something, then it makes sense to have a separate branch where you can do your development, you can do all crazy kind of crazy things, but your master branch still works. You still have a copy of your program which works at any time. So the idea is to branch off the branch from master, where you develop a feature. If this feature in the end turns out to be stupid, you just throw away this branch. If this branch develops an interesting feature which you can really use, you merge it later on into the master branch. That's the idea of branches. And that's a very important concept. So let's suppose we want to develop our prime number function. Then we can add a branch. For example, you might have shown your script to somebody who knows more about prime numbers, and he has, or she has told you that there is this Eratosthenes sieve of Eratosthenes to create a list of prime numbers. And you think this is a great idea, I'm going to implement this. Now, it's not a good idea to throw away the code you already have and replace it. You just branch off another branch where you do your development. So let's do that. So to change to a new branch, or to, let's say, to change to a branch, you would do something like that. could say checkout. This would switch to another branch. The problem is this branch with this name, which I have chosen here, does not yet exist, so this is not working. So if you want to check out a branch which doesn't exist yet, you just say minus B. This will create a new branch. That's why option minus B. And he tells you switch to a new branch, Eratosthenes. So if now you check the branch, you see that there are two branches, Master and Eratosthenes. So now we have to write a routine for Eratosthenes. So we use primes.py. Now I'm not going into the details. Let me just say from math, import square root, import numpy as np. And then we have the function Eratosthenes of nmax. Is np1, so I'm using NumPy, who was in my tutorial yesterday, will recognize these things here, nmax plus 1. Dtype is boolean. C, for the first two elements, these are no prime numbers, so that should be false. For candidate, in range from 2 to int square root of n max plus 1. If c of candidate, steps of candidate is false. And primes is then np a range of nmax plus 1 c return primes. So this returns a list of primes up to nmax. This is nice. Hopefully it works. We're going to see this later on. Maybe we also improve the finish typing laws. I'm going to change the prime time file. Sometimes with pi. Then I import Eratosthenes. And let me change this to this time of n for n in Eratosthenes of 2359. Okay, check this. 211. Typing it. This is the primes file, and this is the primes. No, sorry, this is the prime time file. Okay, and now we have two new files with new functionality. It seems to work, so we do a commit. Pretty standard, git add primes.py, primetime.py, git commit minus m, all this, make use of Yeah, I want to do this in actually in two steps. Let me, sorry. Just make a nicer history. Git status. Okay, now we have primes.py in the staging area we committed. And the same with use of test and sorry, edit C4. Customers, and then we add primes, primetime.py, and commit it, we say make use of error customers in primetime. Does anybody need to see one of the files again? Which one? Prime time. Few versions. The only point is that we are now here on the here we were on the branch master, and then we switched to the branch error customers. Now to make this even more interesting, at the same time, you might have realized that you could have improved the other primes routine, right? Because if you look at error customers. And you see that actually the maximal candidate, which makes sense at all, is basically the square root of the number you're testing. You can never have two prime factors of a number which are bigger, both bigger than the square root, because their product would be bigger than the number you're testing. So at this point you say maybe, oh, this is a great idea, I can improve this routine here. But this has nothing to do with Eratosthenes. So let's go back to master, because that's an easy change. That's what our customers are using all the time. We make a small change for them, but for Eratosthenes we're going to charge a lot of money. So that will be a separate version, okay? Or new version. So, git branch tells us that we are in Eratosthenes and we want to go to master. How do we do that? We say git checkout. Master. Now the important point is if now I look at primes.py, there's no Eratosthenes. Of course, because Eratosthenes is in the Eratosthenes branch. But here I can now improve this code a little bit. Say from math called square root. And it's good enough to go up to int of square root of n plus 1. Let's check whether it still runs correctly. Python primetime.py is 211, still works. So we can check it in. There was this question about adding this two-step process may be considered as a bit too lengthy. What you can do is if you have just one file, you can say minus git commit minus a. And the point is the following. In this case, only primes has been affected. Now you can just say git commit minus A. This will add the files which are already tracked here and committed. So you can say git commit minus A minus M instead of saying git commit git add this file and then git commit this file. You can say git commit minus A minus M. And then we can say that we approved crime test. Now we are in a situation that we have on the master branch, we have a new version. On the Eratosthenes branch, we have a different version. So let's take a look at it. Git log graph branches one line. That's how it looks like. See, this is the master branch, which contained the first three commits, which contains a new commit here. That's the small change we have, which we have made. And there's the Eratosthenes branch, which contains also two new commits. So we have done changes in parallel. And then maybe they're not compatible. So let's see. So now we are still in master. Now you're saying, okay, Eratosthenes was a great idea. Let's merge Eratosthenes into master. Want to have a new great version for our customer? So we say git merge Eratosthenes. Poof, conflict. Major catastrophe. So the automatic merge failed, and git just tells us fix the conflicts and then commit the result. Okay, what happens here? I mean, this can happen, of course, if you're working on the same code as your colleague, then you might do conflicting changes. In many cases, there's no problem because you're working in different parts of the code, and it's fine to make changes there and independent changes there. And then this merge will just work fine. But there are situations where the changes are in conflict. And then somebody has to take a look at them and fix them. Take the decision which is the right correction to do. Right? So what does git tell us? It tells us the merge conflict is in primes.py. So let's take a look at primes.py. And in primes.py, we see here there are two versions, basically the version of head, that's what we have in master, and the version which was found in Eratosthenes. And git is unsure whether we really want to have this import numpy as np here. But of course we know, because we know what's going on here, we know that we need numpy, so basically we just have to fix this. It's easy. Just delete this, this, and this. And that's how we want it. And then we are happy. Okay? So the general rule is you always have two alternatives. The alternative between this and this. Oh, I put it. Oh, this is in the wrong way, actually. Sorry, that's a mistake. I have to change this. There are these two versions, and you just have to decide which one do you want. You prepare the correct version, and then you can commit the file. Okay. Oops. So now you can say git commit minus A. Merge branch Eratosthenes is fine. And now we have now you see that we have merged Eratosthenes successfully into master. So you see, this is a typical situation. You branch off a feature branch, you do something there, and you put it back into your master branch.
And the next question, here you use an editor in the terminal.
Yes.
What if I use an editor in the background? And I say,
what do you mean by editor in the background?
I mean,
you mean a graphic tool?
Emacs.
You could use Emacs, that's fine. Yeah.
Yes.
Meaning
I don't close it on a new project when I'm changing.
You should at least save it.
Yes.
You need to.
Emacs will reload it for you. Emacs will reload it for you.
Yeah.
Emacs already for you?
Yeah. I'm not an Emacs guy, but I trust
Beam you. Beam does it as well.
Yeah. Now, at this point, you could decide Eratosthenes was nice, we don't need it anymore. You can actually delete this branch. I'm probably not going to do this, but... no. Oops. Deleting a branch can be done by saying git branch minus uppercase D branch name. The idea is that uppercase switches are unusual. So that means attention, danger. You want to delete something. So whenever you type an uppercase option, you should think twice about what you're doing. Because if you delete a branch, you delete a branch. It's gone. So then, let's do it. Git branch minus D, Eratosthenes branch. Then we are back on master and there's no Eratosthenes branch anymore. This is specifically useful if you want to clean up or if you have a branch well, you tried something out and you found out that this is not making sense after all. Well, actually, what's maybe important to realize is that the old version still exists. It's not that everything is completely lost. I mean, you just don't have the branch anymore. In particular, you can look at a specific version here. So you could look, for example, at this version here by saying, let me show this here, by referring to the version which you are interested in. So the most recent version is head, and you can look at previous ones. So the parent is head with this circumflex here. The second parent is circumflex 2. Can go to grandparents and so on. I'll be a bit brief here because time is running out. Let's do the following. Let's take a look at this version here, 9A2AE11. You can simply say git checkout, or in our case here it's A92062. Then it says, head is now at A92062. That's the version from our Eratosthenes branch. But there's something which is maybe surprising. Git says you're in a detached head state. What the hell is a detached head state? That means you're looking at a version, it's like a read-only copy. You can take a look at the files which are there, but you cannot change them. This is basically detached. It's like a copy which you put aside and you can take a look at it, but you cannot really work on it. If you want to work with this version, you have to attach it again. For example, you could say git checkout minus b, exp- experimental, for example. Then in this experimental branch, you have precisely this version which was in a detached branch, detached head state before. Right? So now I have a branch in which I could work, which is really based on this specific version. Now I realize that this is becoming complicated now, so try to keep this short. It's just to give you an impression of what may be possible here. And in particular, you might end up in this detached head state. That's nothing really problematic. It just means that you can only look at the content at this point. If you do want to do some work, you have to check out a branch based on this version.
Could you just
yes.
quickly show the GitLog for this situation?
Yes. Maybe it's nice to see the decorate. So here this is master. This is our present head, our detached head here, which now is also basically experimental. So here, so if I would make a change to experimental, I would branch off from here. Okay. Now, one point which was asked before is, can you tag versions? And I said, yes, you can, and that's something I want to show you. So, let's go to master. And let's say git tag minus a, first final. That's the first version which we think is sort of a final product. So we give it a tag, first final, we annotate it, there's a comment, minus m, the first recently complete version. Maybe I want to have an early version as well. Let me take an old version. This is possible as well, a version 0.1. I just give, let's take this version here, for example, 4.7, D3, FE4, minus M, it was an early version. And then we have these two tags which refer to well-defined versions of our program. That was basically the question at the beginning. Okay. Now, the problem is that I'm out of time. So, I've basically done the Git material, but so far you have it only locally on your machine. If you're interested in GitHub, give me another 5 minutes or so. I can tell you more about it. If you think that 1.5 hours is really enough, and if you want to leave, feel free. I don't want to really force you to stay here. But if you're really interested, and I saw some people nodding, then I go on for a few minutes. I try to be brief, but try to give you at least some idea of the main points. But I mean, don't feel obliged to stay here. So, working with GitHub, what is GitHub? Well, GitHub is this website, github.com, and GitHub hosts Git projects. That's basically a service where projects are hosted. And this server here facilitates the communication between your projects. I mean, the problem is that either you set up connections between these different computers, or you have a central computer with which you talk, and where other people can take your work. Now, the point is that public repositories are hosted for free. So you don't have to pay for it. Whereas private repositories are not free. So if you're working for a company and you want to do nobody else should really see. Then you have a private repository, and then you have to pay for it. I mean, prices are actually pretty reasonable. And if you're working at a university, but for your research you need a private repository, you can always send an email to GitHub and ask for a certain number of private repositories. They will usually grant you a small number of private repositories, provided you send it through the university address. They should be able to verify that you're really working for the university. And since all these public repositories are free, GitHub is extremely popular among open source projects. So that means if you want to contribute to any of these projects which are discussed here, probably all of them are hosted on GitHub, and then you should know how you work with GitHub. Now there are a few things which you want to do there. For example, if you want to have my tutorial, then you could just clone the tutorial from GitHub, because all this material which I'm showing you, in particular this presentation, is hosted on GitHub. Right? So if you go to Git tutorial, and there's some material here, and if you want to have this material, you can just clone this. So what you would say is following. Go to directly git clone https github.com your sci-pi git tutorial. Now if you don't want to have the full history of what I have been doing, mistakes I have done in the past in this repository, you can just say, let me get the most recent version, equals one, already exists, okay, okay, that's the Wi-Fi, which is not, not great here. But in principle, you get a Git repository where you can work on if you want to, where you have all the files which are found in the repository. Let me... no, it's finished, so you see, you can go to your sci-fi Git tutorial. We have a Git repository, so you really have a Git repository. You have some files, for example, a gitignore file. You can look at the source of the presentation and at the images, how they are prepared, and so on. But you only got the most recent version, right? Not the older ones. Now this is the simple part, just getting a repository. Now, how does the workflow work if you work with other people? The point is the following. You have a local repository for which you have read permission and write permission. But nobody else can read from your computers, hopefully. Now, what GitHub has is another repository. Let's say you're working, you want to contribute to another open source project, for example. Then this project, which is living there, for example, NumPy or SciPy or something, is called upstream. And the maintainer or the users who are having access to this repository, they have read and write access, and you have just read access. So you can read from here, as you did from my repository, but there's no way back. So the idea is the following in the first step. That's to make a fork. A fork means making a copy of the upstream repository, which now is a repository in its own right. That's usually called origin. Now the maintainer has read permission from origin, because it's a fork of upstream, and you have read and write permission. So now you can really start to collaborate because you can pull the most recent changes from upstream. You can do work. And you can push this work to origin, your repository on GitHub. And if you have done something interesting where you think this should be part of this open software project, you can do something which is called a pull request. On GitHub it's called a merge request, which is basically a request to the maintainer to check your contribution, and if they like it, to take the code from origin and put it into upstream. That's the way how you can contribute to an open source project. Now, I think, given that the time is already already almost 10 minutes beyond the end of the tutorial, I think what you can do is you just clone my repository and you just check out these pages. I've tried in this presentation to be rather explicit so that you can follow everything which I've told you. You can follow it again. There are all these outputs which are produced by the various commands. So I think at this point I just propose that you take a look at the last few pages of this presentation. And well, I hope that at the end of this tutorial you don't have the impression, oh, this is terribly complicated. Of course, at the beginning this always seems to be very complicated, but once you get into it, you'll find that it can save you a lot of time. And even if you just do your scientific work and you produce data, just imagine that at some point you find out there was a mistake in your program. Right? That can happen. People make mistakes. I certainly have done mistakes in my programs. You try to avoid it, but it can happen, and you have a lot of data produced over time. Now, suppose what happens if you don't know whether these data are affected by the problem, by the bug which you had in your program. And suppose how nice it would be that you have in your output a hash of your commit or a tag which says this was produced with this version of my project. Then you can say, these data can be thrown away, and these data are still fine. I think that's a situation where version control can be extremely helpful, apart from being able to collaborate with people, for example. So I hope I have to convince you at least to think about it, and maybe at some point, hopefully at one of the future EuroSci guys, come to me and tell me it was great to get started with it. Thank you.